show, we interview entrepreneurs, state officials, and even your day-to-day citizens to get insight on topics we feel deserve more attention.
And I'm your host, Juliana, and today our guest, Harold, founder and CEO of Y.E.S. Establishing Standards, is here sharing some insight with us about today's topic.
Today's topic is going to be the power of mentorship. Profiles of mentors and role models who have influenced young people in a positive way, interviews with mentors and mentees about their experiences and college experiences.
So, welcome. First
up, thank you for
joining us.
For sure.
And can you tell us a little bit about yourself before we start?
Yes. I am an educator, you know, a philanthropist. I'm a West Philly boy. I'm a father, a husband. You know, I consider myself one of the greatest thinkers of this time. I'm a kid from West Philadelphia that put in the work to be the 2022 valedictorian of St. Joe's grad class. I am a man that knows his strength, as well as a man that prides himself on being able to pour into the youth as a mentor, right? As a teacher, a former teacher, now as an administrator. But I like to say now I just got coined and stamped as everybody's favorite uncle.
You so definitely did.
I'm going right with that, y'all. It's stamped today officially. I'm everybody's favorite.
For a fact, though. But that's really, though, this is a thorough guy right here. Like, this is not our first time meeting. This is a thorough guy right here. We not making him talk to y'all for no reason. We giving this platform for him.
The vibes is there.
The vibes is there. The vibes is vibing. Everybody's favorite uncle. We're saying it ourselves. Thank you. Clock it.
So, let's get started. What common traits should mentors have that make them good at mentoring? And how do these traits help their mentees succeed?
The biggest trait, I would say, is patience. You know, one, patience with themselves as an individual. I can't really show you something that I don't know. So I feel like patience is something that is modeled. And that a lot of times is what I try my best to give my mentees, my students, my scholars, is just the vantage point of my life. Like, listen, slow down, let the ancestors guide your steps is what I like to say. Mm. But slow down and really plot out and plan out your life. Because you will be here one day. I feel like oftentimes the youth feel like they won't make it to this point, right? And then once you discover that you are, it happens so fast that you're like stuck in a hustle and bustle. That you talked earlier about your dreams as a youth are limitless and they're so bright. Well, the further you get into the workforce and in the adulthood, you have more to lose. And it ends up being a situation where you can't dream as big. So for me, what I want every mentor to have is one, like a glimmer of hope, right? That they are still a dreamer. Because how can I take you and tell you to live out your dreams if I'm not doing so myself, right? Mm-hmm. I kind of would be a hypocrite. Mm-hmm. So you have to have patience with young people because they're not perfect. For me, perfection doesn't exist. That's something that white supremacy developed to make us think we're less than, right? But progress exists. So patience is the key to understanding your progress. If you upset because you didn't make it overnight and you're not successful right away, you won't push through to the end to get to where you need to be. So for me, patience is really the key. Patience is a virtue. That's why people say that. But also being a dreamer yourself and understanding that your dreams can come true at any age. You know what I mean? It doesn't have to happen in your 20s. It's something that could happen in your 50s, your 60s, or later.
Absolutely. And as a mentor, how do you feel that your background has influenced the way that you take on your role as a mentor?
I feel like my background is one of realness, authenticity. Like y'all said, like my vibe is my vibe. Like something that I've always tried to be is my true self. But I learned that the hard way. That's why I pour that into my scholars now. And I pour that into the youth now to kind of like be yourself, be a snowflake, your grain of sand on a beach. Because what we all bring to the table, that individuality is like what makes us great. So for me, all my past trials, tribulations, my experiences, my mistakes for me is the key. Is sharing my mistakes with y'all so y'all don't make the same ones. But all of those experiences like, you know, culminate and sum up who I am now. So for me, that is why I come off as everybody's favorite uncle. And I come off as authentic because that is all of my experiences. I'm not making anything up. You know what I mean? I'm just living my truth. And me living my truth day to day allows my scholars not only to hear it at first, because y'all heard it a few years ago, but then y'all got to see me walk in it. And when you see me walking in my truth, you start to understand that it is. It's a stamp of who he is. He not playing. You know what I mean? He not up here faking it because it's a Tuesday night. Like, no, this him Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. So I feel like my authenticity in my experiences and being able to share them, vulnerability is key. And this goes to all of my kings, my young black boys. It's okay to be authentic in your truth. It's okay to be vulnerable and share your energy and your emotions with others. Sometimes you need to shed a tear at more spaces than a funeral. You need to shed a tear when your sister graduate and is going to Clark Atlanta University and you know you're going to miss her, right? You know what I mean? Like somebody up here right now. But it's just, it's the realness is in the vulnerability. And for me to be able to share my trials and tribulations, my mistakes, right? I often say, I'm going to wrap up because I don't want to go too long, but I often laugh at how guys have come home from jail and talk about it in a way that is like making it seem like some type of party, some type of great situation, right? They don't, we don't hold that truth, right? And now other young black boys are thinking, oh, all right, I'll go to Club Fed, I'll go to the party. Like, whereas if we come in and we show that truth and vulnerability and your uncle crying in front of you, like he crying on the phone to your grandmom, asking her to put the house up for his bell, if you saw those tears and you heard that conversation, you would definitely think twice about trapping on the same block he was trapping on. But the fact that they hold that veil up on us and hold that mirror up, because the rest of the world see what jail is. Mm-hmm. It's like for us, we glamorize it, and we what it really is we just rationalize what we feel like we have no control over. We rationalize what we feel like is the inevitable. And young black boys feel like it's just part of the program or rites of passage for them to go to jail. That's why I go out of my way as an educator to show them, nah, your rites of passage is going to the Bahamas. Like I just took my 8th graders last week. My 7th graders right now traveling up to Canada. It's like, no, this your rite of passage. This the way you supposed to go. Not that way uphill into the jails and all of that.
Keeping it authentic and real is very important. So I'm glad that you put a highlight on that, because that is very important, especially growing up in Reading too.
Yeah.
Like, you have to be yourself. Like, there's no way. I wouldn't have gotten anywhere if I wasn't myself and I wasn't who I was. Like, if I wasn't who I was, I wouldn't have gotten so far.
Yeah.
And so I definitely agree with that.
And I know for Reading, you know, like, back when I was up here a few years ago, probably like over a decade now, but it was like gangs and things. And like, I understand that is the fastest way for a young kid to get involved. And in Philly, it's not gangs per se, like, you know, the typical pop culture blood Crips, but it's blocks. Like, yo, I'm from this street, you from that street, and this our territory. But the kids get looped into that because they don't know who they are, right? They don't know who they want to be. They have not identified their truth yet, and then the hood give it to you. Well, this is who you are.
Right.
Jay posted, you a gangster, yeah. Bro. Come on out here with the gangsters and kick it. And now if you don't know and you don't have nowhere to go, you don't have a setting like this to kind of guide you in a different direction, you like, yeah, I'll go kick it with the homies. My uncle out there anyway. Bet, let's go. And now it's perpetuating that stereotype. It's continuing that line and that cycle of nonsense. So, you know what I mean? I'm glad that shows like this exist. I'm glad that queens like y'all exist because y'all standing on business.
Thank you.
It also is a breaker of the chains because y'all can be out here on some goofiness, but y'all out here empowering the youth. So kudos to y'all and what y'all do here with this platform because it is helping to change things.
Thank you. So, and I don't even think I realize it on a regular basis how much this is like affecting our city. Like, I really just be doing this. Like, this is just a regular Tuesday for me. Like, I'm just chilling, like, recording. Mm-hmm. This is what I like to do. This comes out of passion.
Mm-hmm.
So this is never because, like, I'm forced to do this. Like, this is a passion that I have.
From the heart, yo.
Yeah.
Ashe.
So do you feel that it's important for mentors to have similar backgrounds and experiences as their mentees?
So I don't feel... it's like that's like I'm gonna give you both sides. So I'm gonna say on the first hand, yes, because, for example, where I'm headed in like educational leadership, I kind of have been tapping in with people that are where I want to be, and I feel like that's the important thing about a mentor. You want a mentor to be where you want to be. Like if they on the same level as you, y'all kind of colleagues. Y'all not. Mm-hmm. A mentor should be in a position that can push you along or pull you along, right? Mm-hmm. One of those things. But also, you can't limit yourself to one hustle. So with that said, there's no reason why I right now can't have a mentor that is in the tech field, that is leading the cutting edge on new digital cameras or AI that's coming out, because AI may be leading the path for education in a few years. And if I'm partnered with that mentor, now I'm ahead of the curve of any mentor that I could have had in education. This one mentor from over here in AI now puts me ahead of any mentor I could have had in education, because it's outside of the box. So it's important for you to diversify yourself. You should never limit yourself to one person, and especially never limit yourself to your surroundings or your environment, which means you just looking for a mentor in this area. I have to know you. You don't know my aunt? Oh, you can't mentor me. No, sometimes the best mentor you'll have is a person you have never met before, or a person you met at age, how old are you?
17.
So you're 17, right? You never met this person before, but quick segue, one of my mentors is a doctor in Philadelphia, right? She is an amazing principal that runs the school that I work for, and she graduated from Clark Atlanta. I had to hit her up like, yo, I know this queen, she's amazing. Like, she's going to Clark Atlanta. She like, listen, tell her hit me up. So now that's how you gain a mentor. You may never even meet her face to face, but you could text her and say, hey, what English professor should I take? Hey, where is the best place for me to go and try to find a job on campus? All of these things, right? And again, it's a person you never gonna meet face to face until you successful, right? You having your black gown elegant event and your mentors pop up. Because that's how it go in life for successful people. It's not always about receiving praise in a moment. It's like you plant the seed today, the tree grow in the shade for somebody else. You may never get back to that shade. It's at one time when you get a cup of lemonade under that joint. But other than that, like, you keeping it moving because that's your path. So I say that to say, when you're searching for a mentor, don't limit yourself. The mentorship should be part tapping into that limitless dream you have of yourself, of, yo, President Obama should be my mentor. Again, he my mentor in my head. I have a lot of those that, like, I channel people off camera. We spoke about how I channel Black Panther and T'Challa to get my king on. Like, it's certain, especially for black men, again, young black boys, y'all gonna have moments of trials and tribulations where you gotta push yourself through. It's nothing your mom could do, nothing your friends gonna do to motivate you. It's all you. You got the ball in your hands and the clock is ticking. Are you gonna get buckets or no? What I do in those moments, I literally channel T'Challa. I in my brain, it plays that Mortal music when he was challenging me for the kingship, and then like I get amped up and I'm on go. But it's important to have mentors that are far-fetched. Because if I ever get in a room with Obama, right, President Obama, best believe one of the first things I'm going to ask him is, hey, how you doing? Pleasure. Nice to meet you. Hey, can I get a business card or something to somebody to talk to? Because I need a mentor. And I may not end up with Obama as my mentor, but I may end up with one of his, like, administrative assistants or somebody that can then I could put the call in and get some funding for y'all or the Solidarity Camp or something like that. So never limit yourself to a mentor that's just around you. You know what I mean? Or a mentor that only has the same things that you have, that only has things in common that you like. Never limit yourself, but start there. That's a good starting point with the person that is at your school or your church or your rec center that you see doing positive things. That's a start, but never limit yourself when it comes to a mentor.
Time and clock that.
Right, definitely. So with that, how do you feel mentors are different from role models, and what benefits do you think that they bring to the growth of young people?
That's a good job. See, for me, role models, to me, a role model could be somebody like you watch from a distance. You know what I mean? Like, a role model could be someone that you never interact with, right? I feel like the interaction is the key that defines the difference between a role model and a mentor. And the example I'll use is a lot of my scholars have LeBron James as a role model. Well, it's kind of changed now because LeBron getting old, but y'all get my point. Mm-hmm. So insert basketball player here. Right. That's their role model. Oh, I want to be Steph Curry, or I want to be, or a rapper, right? That is like their role model. They emulate that. A mentor comes in and says, yo, but you are amazing at poetry, like the king that just sat here. You're amazing at poetry, and they take that kid that has, who LeBron James still gonna be his role model while he in poetry class, and his mentor is coaching him up on conflict resolution and self-expression, and he's writing all these poems, and he gets the scholarship to college and all of that. That's what a mentor does. The role model is just over there living a life, and you looking at Beyonce like, oh, how I would love to be that. But the mentor show you how to be that. If not, it show you how not to be what's not that, right? Because sometimes a good mentor also will tell you straight up, like, yo, there's nothing I could do for you at this point. You have reached, like, the maximum spot I could get for you. Like, you got to go forth and prosper. Like, we kind of, like, equals now. And that's something that has happened to me several times when I went from a guy with a bachelor's, because I took the long road. So I went, I got my associate's degree. I was working for a little bit. I was like, oh, this ain't it. I went back, and my mentor I met when I started working at a school in Chester, PA, shout out to Dr. E, he was like, yo, you got to go back to school. You're wasting your time. What are you doing? And, like, again, I'm thinking a mentor got to be somebody I grew up with. This is where I learned that lesson. And he, like, no, he mentored me. He was like, you got to wear shoes to work. Dress for the job you want, not the job you have. Like, he just give, he gave me all these jewels that, like, literally helped me get myself together. Once he left, I met Dr. Williams, again, another doctor. This is a pattern, y'all. But I met Dr. Williams, who was like the first black woman that was outside of my family that believed in me, like in the education world. She's like, yo, you really do this. Like, you know, you could probably run your own school one day. I'm like, really? She's like, yeah, like, what degree you got? You got a master's? I'm like, no, I got an associate's degree. She's like, oh, I don't know. I was like, let me get back to school. Jump right back in, got my bachelor's. And then that transitioned me into where I am now, where it was like, I'm in a class, y'all know my hustle. I'm like, I'm about to run circles around these dudes. That's how I ended up being valedictorian and giving a speech and everything at the 2022 SJU grad class graduation. Mm-hmm. It's all off the grind. Like, I quoted Biggie in that joint and everything, and I felt proud because St. Joe's is like a prestigious Catholic university, right? They focus on religion and all of those core values. So for me to be up there, West Philly Bull, you know what I mean? Everything I done been through, quoting Biggie and then the whole crowd cheering, it was like a moment for me. I call that like my biggest stage yet. After today, I'm gonna stamp this as my biggest stage. But for me in that moment, you know what I mean? It was just an energy that was a little bit different for me. But I don't wanna get off. I know we gotta wrap it up. I know we gotta get to our next question. But yeah.
So what methods do you use to keep your mentees enlightened and keep them in a positive mindset despite everything going on around us?
Well, Instagram is a beautiful thing, and social media, because I can share cool things with them, like different stories about like history and things I share a lot of. But also it's just like talking straight like that. Like, listen, sometimes we got to tap in. I got to talk to you face to face about what you're not doing right or what you are doing right. And I want to focus more on what you are doing right, because far too often we don't hear what we're doing right. Y'all talked about the gun violence in Reading. Y'all talked about all of the craziness that goes on that gets publicized more than these type of shows, more than like the solidarity camp and things. So for me, I feel like it's important to continue to highlight these things and continue to tell our own narrative, right? And tell our own stories and make sure that the vision of us is positive and we keep a hold of that positive image. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Because if not, you allow anybody to skew it and take it and run with it. And then it becomes the nonsense we see today all over the place. So I go hands-on with my mentors. I mean, with my mentees. Just the same way I want my mentors to coach me and help me. I got to tap in with you. But also, I do the open door policy because I be busy. I got to live my own life. I got to raise my kids. So if you need help, ask for help. The squeaky wheel, get the oil. So just like I told y'all need something, call me. I'm there. If I can be. If I can't, I'll try to help you in any way I can. But that is really the key for me, is keeping myself available to my mentees. And even if it's as simple as a quick phone call during a tough time or whatever, then I feel like as long as I'm available, we straight.
Okay. And for our last question for you, what gave you...
Before we end, what high school did you go to?
I went to Lamberton in West Philly. Shout out, West Philly Winners.
Oh, so you stayed in the area?
Yeah, I stayed in West Philly my whole life, all of my schooling. You know what I mean? I graduated from Lamberton in 2002, and then I went to Delaware State University, HBCU. Shout out to the HBCUs. That's where I started my college path, but life took me in a different direction, and I ended up finishing up at St. Joe's.
Bye-bye. So Going into you, Miss Girl.
Mm-hmm. HBCU time.
What
baby.
HBCU yeah. going to? Cause
make that announcement. Make that announcement.
So in the fall of 2024, I will be attending the illustrious Clark Atlanta University in Atlanta, Georgia, as a freshman.
Let's go.
Are you so excited?
I'm so excited. I can't even.
How long you been wanting this? How you feel like this is what you want? What's up?
I knew I was going to Clark since I was in the fourth grade.
Yep.
Let's go.
So I knew that no matter what I went through, I always had Clark in mind. Like, it didn't matter what happened, I'm going to Clark. Like, it don't matter. So to look at me now, like, it's crazy to see my growth and how that actually came. God pulled through for me.
So, I just want to say I'm so proud of you. I don't want to get emotional, but I'm so proud of you because I feel like I watched you come from, like,
Thank you.
You feel me? I've always watched you fight for everything that you have. Like, I'm not gonna lie. Like, you give me a lot of inspiration throughout my days. Oh, like, you push so hard for what you want. And, like, you get it all. Like, if somebody's not gonna give it to you, you're gonna get it. And that's what I admire about you the most. So, what are you most excited about going into this HBCU? Like, what's up? Like, what do you feel like? Because I'm excited for you. You gotta be outside.
Honestly, I'm excited for the community. You know, growing up, I was an only child, so I was by myself for a lot of the time. I spent a lot of time by myself. So being able to be in an area with people who look like me, people who share the same thoughts as me, people who grew up like me, and, you know, now I go to a predominantly white high school, and I have been for the majority of my high school career. So for me to be able to go into a space with people who look like me and want the same things that I want and have been through the same things that I've been through, that's super important to me.
For a fact. So, and I like that you think I'm about it like that, too.
Super excited for.
What's going to be your major? What you going to study?
I'm going to be studying mass media arts with a concentration in radio, TV, and film.
Why did you pick that?
I picked that because I just felt like, you know, when you're, I'm not bragging on myself, but I am. I feel like for creative people, it's so hard to find out where to go. Like, I can do this, I can do that, I can do this. Okay, but that's not what I want to do. So mass media arts, that entire major, and even the concentration, I feel like all the things that I wanted to do, like all the things that I love, like, you know, you grow up watching TV, you grow up listening to music, you grow up, like, things that are so important to me, they played such key roles in my life. I'm finally able to concentrate that into one area and be able to, like, I'm doing something in school that I like. That's insane to me.
For a fact. Are there any specific professors or any programs that you've been looking into before you, like, get there?
Definitely, like I said, media arts program, they have plenty of sub-branches that I could go off to. They can introduce me to studios and production teams and producers. So, honestly, I have no expectations yet. I'm just going to see what the experience offers me, and we're going to take it from there.
And we was talking about this in one of our car rides, right, that what is something that you wanted, that you wish other people going to an HBCU knew before leaving high school? What is something that they didn't tell you that you had to figure out yourself? Because this was a hard process for you. I remember you telling me that this was very difficult. So,
well, I would say, like, keep the end goal in mind, because it's hard. Getting into school, maintaining your grades, doing what you have to do, trying to separate yourself from the people you're not supposed to be around, that is hard. Like, making yourself the perfect person. I've shaped myself since I was in fourth grade to go to the school. Everything I've worked for up to this point, like, this is it.
It's time.
So, it's hard, but you literally have to think, like, I've waited for this so long. So, like, it's so worth it.
How was your high school experience? Like, how do you feel like that's gonna help you get, like, to start?
So, I think I've been about three or four different high schools since, I think three. So, I just feel like that's taught me how to adapt and how to meet new people. And, like, we talked about before, always being yourself. That's so important to me. I wish that I would have known that earlier. But, like, now that I'm finally living in who I am, like, this is what you're going to get, whether you like it or not. This is who I am. This is how I talk. This is how I present myself. This is who I am. So, yeah. I don't know.
See, you well on your way to being everybody's favorite auntie.
Yeah, you out there, buddy. You know, I love everybody. We with it.
Give me some short-term and long-term goals that you have being over there.
Short-term goals, I definitely am excited to see how the experience changes me and how I can develop from this and the people and the relationships that I'll form. And, you know, people build families off of their college experiences. So, like, people can, you can leave with family who aren't even related to you. They're closer to you than anybody ever has been. Mm-hmm. And I even watched that with my mom. She attended Hampton University. And my aunts and uncles, they're not biologically related to her. They went to college together. So that's definitely a short term. And long term, you know, you just want to make everybody proud. You know, me, I want to make my parents proud. You know, I know they're proud of me, but you always got to take it that much higher. Set the bar high for even the people under me. Like, literally shoot for the stars for real.
So, yeah. You didn't talk to the camera. Shoot for the stars.
Shoot for the stars, y'all. Don't ever forget that. The sky is literally not even the limit. Mm-hmm. You could go beyond, so far beyond. All you have to do is work hard. Mm-hmm. Work for everything you want, like Lex said.
My God, I'm so tight that you're... I'm excited, but I'm mad she's leaving me. I'm leaving. It's okay. We're going to make... I need you to send me pictures. Pictures,
we're
all of that.
Forever. Of course, of course.
So how are you going to... How you going to be remembered? When you leave, before you leave that school, what you want them to be like, Juliana? But Juliana, what?
I just want to be the person who, you know, I want to be somebody for everybody, if that makes sense. Yeah. I don't want anybody to feel like they went through the college experience and they don't know who I am, because I have so much to offer. So much love, so much, you know, we be chatting it up, we talking, laughing, like, so much personality to give out. So I just feel like taking advantage of everything that I'm being presented, like, that's definitely...
For a fact, yeah, you definitely have a lot of personality, so I'm happy that you're becoming more, like coming out of your shell more.
Yeah.
Because you used to be a little shy, but she's coming out more, and I'm really happy, because that's what I wanted to see. Like, there's more to you than this smart girl. That's all I gotta
say. You're gonna need it. You're gonna need it on your path. Understand your black girl magic. Understand the value you add to any space. And my advice to you would be the thermostat in the room, right?
Definitely.
Right? You want to set the temperature. You don't want to be the thermometer to tell people what it is. You want to set the temperature in the room. So always remember that you're the thermostat. And these trenches right here that we grew up in gave us our superpower to be that. So be a thermostat.
Thank you. And that's where we're going to end off this episode tonight. Thank you guys so much for watching. Thank you so much for joining us. And Juliana, have an
amazing time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Everybody stay blessed.
Thank you for tuning into our city. We'll see you in our next episode. Peace.
Peace.